Hi there. In this topic video on the balance of payments, we're going to focus on countries that run current account surpluses. Here's a table drawn from the data published by the IMF in 2015 for countries with the largest current account surpluses in the world. Keep in mind that the current account is the balance of trade in goods and services, net primary income from investments overseas, and also net secondary income. I think this table is really quite interesting because it highlights some of the most successful countries in the world in economic terms. Singapore, for example, runs a current account surplus of nearly a fifth of its national income most years. And other countries appear near the table. Taiwan, a leading export nation. Kuwait, heavily dependent, of course, on oil. Germany, the world's biggest manufacturing exporter. And countries such as South Korea, which over the last 15, 20 years have done tremendously well to reach high income, advanced country status. So these are countries which year in, year out, run a significant current account surplus. And in this topic video, we're just going to have a little think about why that happens. What are the main causes of a country running a current account surplus? I want to make a distinction in this topic video between structural causes, which essentially are about supply-side explanations, and cyclical causes, which focus a little bit more on the near term and what's happening in the economic cycle. So let's think first of all about why countries run surpluses from a supply-side point of view. Fundamentally, surplus countries tend to have a surplus of savings over investment. In other words, take a country such as Germany, which has a very high savings rate relative to its investment rate. And those surplus savings could, in theory, have been used to buy imported goods and services, but they haven't. And that's one reason why they're running a current account surplus. But I think of more important in terms of explanation is the fact that many of these countries have built up and protected a significant long-run competitive advantage in one or more industries. So when one thinks about the German economy, for example, one thinks about manufacturing sectors, car making, all the way through to household goods and electronic products. Likewise, in South Korea, companies such as Samsung and LG and Hyundai. So countries that build up significant competitive advantage nearly always see a significant improvement in their trade performance. It could be the case that their main exports have become more expensive in world markets. So the terms of trade have moved in that particular country's favour. And they're getting, for example, a higher price for every barrel of oil they sell. It could also be the case that the current account surplus benefits from a structural increase in the income flows that come from their investments overseas. So, for example, some countries may have had many hundreds of thousands of workers leaving their economy, and they send back their remittance income. That actually adds to their current account balance. Another supply-side reason could be that a country has successfully increased their productivity, and it was measured by output per worker, or perhaps that they have been very successful in innovating through research and development. Here's an interesting chart which shows scientists and engineers per million people on the y-axis, and research and development spending as a percentage of GDP on the x-axis. And notice that countries that appear all close to or near the top right of this diagram, South Korea, Sweden, Finland, Denmark, Singapore, Taiwan, those countries tend to have significant current account surpluses. So does China. But the United States actually runs a current account deficit. However, what I would take from this is that countries which are successful in building up a very strong research and development base and who have many companies and businesses at the cutting edge of technological frontiers, they will tend to do better in international trade. What about cyclical causes of a surplus? So these are more short-term factors, and we would include in that, for example, the possible beneficial effects of a depreciation in the exchange rate, which could make your export sector more competitive overseas. It could be the case that you're benefiting from a boom in consumer demand and spending in your key export markets. And it could be the case there's been a cyclical improvement in the terms of trade. So, for example, you might be a copper exporter and the world price of copper goes up. That automatically feeds through to your balance of payments. On the other hand, it might be the case that the price of a commodity such as oil and gas has gone down in dramatic sense. And if you're an importer of that commodity, then you're going to be spending less on that. And again, that will improve your balance of payments. So these are the difference between structural and cyclical causes of a current account surplus. Let's think a little bit, just to finish off this topic video, about why a current account surplus matters. So China has a current account surplus of around 3% of its GDP. But of course, it's a huge country now, and that translates into enormous surpluses in terms of billions of dollars. One of the consequences of China's current account surplus is they've been able to build up an enormous stock of foreign currency reserves, mainly in dollars, but also in other currencies. So even in 2015, China still has over $3 trillion worth of foreign exchange. What are the other consequences of running a current account surplus? Well, first of all, a surplus is a net contributor, a net positive to aggregate demand. For example, X is greater than M. So one thinks about the aggregate demand equation, C plus I plus G plus X minus M. Then a surplus is going to add to your aggregate demand. And that's good news for growth in the short term. However, it could conceivably cause some demand pull inflationary pressure. We've said, when we mentioned China, that a current account surplus allows a nation to accumulate foreign currency reserves. The key evaluation point, I think, there is how those reserves are used. Are they used productively? So, for example, China has a sovereign wealth fund, and so too does Norway and Qatar. And are those dollars used for productive investments to sustain the long-run growth of a country? Another possible significant effect of a big current account surplus is pressure on the currency to appreciate. And we'll look at the factors that drive currency in a separate tutor to you topic video. The penultimate point is that if you understand the balance of payments accounts, if a nation is running a current account surplus, then that allows them to be a net exporter of capital. Now, that capital could be either deposited in banks overseas, or it could be used to purchase foreign assets. Who knows? But it allows a country to be a net exporter of capital. However, another disadvantage potentially of those big surpluses is it could trigger protectionist sentiment. So this has been a look at countries which run current account surpluses. On the surface, very successful countries, but be able to analyse and evaluate the costs and the benefits of running a balance of payments surplus on the current account.